And right now it's time for that time when we talk to our special guest. Tonight our special guest is Martin Crump. Martin and his five brothers are owners of the copyright of all 26 books written by their dad, Barry Crump. One of these books became the movie The Hunt for the Wilder People. As we speak, the movie continues its successful worldwide release, guaranteeing the production of another movie and more excitement for the Crump family. Martin Crump, welcome to The Beat Goes On.
Thank you, Jared.
Martin, what a wonderful year, 2016. Just look at it, it's going to be your year, isn't it? 2016, you've had the greatest success. Hunt for the Wilder People.
We've done all right so far, haven't we?
Wow, have you done all right? Mm.
Well, Tiger has.
Yes, yeah.
Because the line in the sand with the people that make the movies is that, the authors, the connections of the authors don't get involved because we're not movie makers, so we stand back. Yeah. But we've been kept in the loop all the way through. They've been very kind to us, very generous.
Now, for the one person in New Zealand that doesn't know about The Hunt for the Wilder People, there's probably only one, and they live in Fiordland.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yes.
It's a little hut about 75 kilometres from Queenstown. Well, let's explain it just in case they're watching tonight.
Sure.
Hunt for the Wilder People, where did it all start? It started with Dad, of course, Barry Crump. Everyone of our age group knows your dad, Barry.
Yep.
He wrote a book, and it wasn't called The Hunt for the Wilder People, was it?
It was called Wild Pork and Watercress, and he wrote it in 1986.
Yep.
And he knew, and all the connections knew, it was a goodie.
Yeah.
Sometimes you write a book to put a bit of petrol in the car,
yeah,
and out of Barry's 24 books, there's a few like that,
yeah,
but there's some of them that capture an absolute gem,
yeah,
an atmosphere on a page, and he's managed that with Wild Pork and Watercress. It's a great story.
Yeah. What a great title too, Wild Pork and Watercress.
I thought that was going to be the name of the movie, but they changed it in their wisdom, and it's fine. And
now, you're saying it was first written in 1986?
Yes.
So had great success, just in the Barry Crump style of bringing out a new book every year.
Yeah.
Then it sat there. For years, so
long, that's quite
some time. And how many people believed that it had more potential than just as a book?
Quite a number. Yeah. But to get anything off the ground, and at the movie business, and I've found out a lot of the movie business since then. There was a connection of Lord of the Rings that read it, loved it, and bought the option on it. And he had it for several years.
Mm.
He ended up still being a part of it at the finish. But Taika was the one that says, "I've got to grab this thing by the shirt.
Now,
get it going."
Let's explain Taika. His full name, Taika?
Taika Waititi.
It's a hard one, isn't it? Taika Waititi.
Mm.
Now, he did a fabulous movie called Boy.
He went off and made Boy because our movie was taking too long.
Oh, okay.
So he was, Taika had already written the screenplay, and the original person, the original person to play the lead role in it was Billy Connolly. And as we know now, Billy's not a well
not
man.
There, yeah, yeah.
So that didn't happen.
But did Taika hear about the story then and want to do it?
Well, he'd read it.
Yep.
Then there was another director of a movie who did Mount Zion.
Mm.
And he read it.
Yeah.
And he's going, "Oh my goodness." So he emailed us as well and says, "I cannot believe the story I've just read."
So there's three people
involved. Yeah, so Wild Pork, and he wanted it so bad. And Taika says, "Look, I'm going to have to run with this."
Yeah.
So Taika and I had another meeting.
Yeah.
And since then, of course, everything gold. Because originally it was going to be like $11 or $12 million movie to make.
Mm.
And,
that's hard to get, isn't it?
Oh, it is. Yeah. It is. And Taika said, "Look, movies aren't made like that anymore."
Thank God for that.
Yes. This movie took 5 weeks to shoot.
Yeah.
That was it. 5 weeks all done.
Yeah.
3 months to edit. And then out she goes. And it was a $3.5 to $4 million movie. There you go. And told a great Kiwi yarn. And it did it well because, as we can see with the results, the whole thing is about capturing the relationship between the grumpy old European
and
guy.
A young boy.
And a small, chubby little brown fella and Julian. And it was about capturing that relationship. And it did it.
When did the title change to Hunt for the Wilder People?
It was Hunt for the Wilder People was a working title all the way through the movie.
Really?
The whole making of it for about 12 months.
Yeah.
And we were all thinking, is it going to change? Not too sure about whether I like the name or not. You know, not our choice, but there you go. And it stayed. and they used it. And you see the connection in the movie
to
that. Because young Julian reads a book because he loves his reading. Yeah. So he's in one of the huts, one of the hunters and trappers' huts, and he reads a story about the wilder people. Mm. And he called him and Sam, they called themselves the wilder people.
Some of our viewers will be saying to themselves, who owns the wild pork and watercress, or who owns the story today?
Me.
Wow, that's great, isn't it?
Myself and my brothers. Yep. We have a trust.
How many brothers?
There's six.
Six brothers.
Well, you see, Barry had six boys. Mm. That's what he had.
Yeah.
One brother I haven't met yet, but I've met most of them. But I've got eight marriages between my mother and father.
Yeah.
So I do have others besides the six.
Did Barry get married eight times?
Five.
Oh, five times.
Mum three,
yeah.
Barry five.
He was a wonderful man, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was very different, and he left his mark in a pretty good way. He wasn't here for a long time. He was only 61.
And are you on your way to eight marriages at all?
No,
you're a bit slow compared
to that. Yeah, no, I'm just not as venturous and not interested in marriages.
So what was it about Dad that made him leave? Did you ever find out what gave him the wandering eye?
His upbringing.
Yeah?
Yeah, his upbringing. Any one of the children of Wally, my grandfather, as soon as they got the leaving age, they all left.
Did they?
The second they could leave, they left.
So Wally must have been a bit of a tyrant.
Oh, yeah, he was a monster. Yeah.
Wally Crump.
Wally Crump.
Where did Wally live?
Wally was Otahoo.
Yeah.
Pepatelli. All the Crumps were born in Otahoo.
Yeah.
And he was South Auckland man. Shear milker.
Yep.
Rode a horse a lot out that way in those days. Swapped clothing. Did a bit of this and that, but he was brutal.
Yeah.
He was a monster, Jared, and there's no way out of it. So
he actually got stuck into the boys?
And his wife, Lily, my grandmother, Lily.
She was good at it too.
Dealt to her horribly, horribly, Jared.
Oh, sorry, he dealt to her as well.
Yes, they found a piece of her scalp in the bathroom one day.
Oh.
He was disgusting. And of course, in those days, you didn't
it was
go...
silent, wasn't it?
Well, you didn't talk about the man of the house, because he ruled.
Mm.
So nothing was said. Swept under the carpet, you keep quiet. And everyone lived in fear and in terror. And in fact, my uncle Colin wrote just a magnificent book that we should all read in our family. And it's called An Endless Fear. And that's what the children lived in. You read that.
Yeah.
And I've told my brothers, read the book and you'll understand why Barry could not hang around and be Dad. So he just did his best.
So all the boys, as soon as they got to an age where they could leave, boom.
Yep.
And Barry was one of them.
Barry gone. So he's wandered all his life. He's never stayed any more than 2 years.
Mm.
2 years is a long time. And he had a little part in the city. He'd pop into the city and we'd catch up and we'd say hi and then he'd be gone again. And he'd hit the road. And he loved the adventure of getting the white line down the middle of the highway, a mate to sit with, and off they'd go. So a lot of his books were written about that, just hitting the highway and going.
Now, this ability to write engaging types, page after page, did he ever talk about where that came from, or was that just natural? He just picked up a pencil and a paper one day. Of course, it would have been. There was no computers.
Handwritten. All his books handwritten,
and
Jared.
Just started.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And look, to this day, phenomenal.
Mm.
I'm aghast. Sitting, you know, okay, being a son, I can be biased, but I'm not biased.
Because
I only spent a year with him, a full year of my life, really.
Yeah.
And I got to know him over that year. But other than that, I didn't spend time with him. But I am, you know, you're in the presence of a great storyteller when you spend some time with him, Jared.
And
it's so good.
Were you ever there when, not one of the stories in the books, but he had a couple of beers and he started telling you a story that never made any of the books and you'd be listening to it?
Oh, yeah.
How did he weave those stories? Was he good verbally at telling those stories?
He just captured you.
Yeah.
He had a very good... he had a good human touch with people.
Yeah.
He could read people well too. A good heart knowledge he had.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting down. I've just been to my brother's wedding and Barry had turned up. And we both camped in a quarry.
Mm.
And the quarry was cold, stones everywhere, but Barry made a fire. And the next thing I know, I'm hungry. I hadn't eaten.
Yeah.
And all we had was butternut, a squash.
Yeah.
And I don't like pumpkin. I'm going, oh my goodness, is that all we got to eat?
Yeah.
So anyway, he cooked it up on the camp oven. It was beautiful because I didn't want to break the spell of the story.
Yeah.
And the other thing, I'm sitting in shorts and a t-shirt. And I'm going, I want to go to my car and get something on.
Yeah.
But if I did, I'd break the spell of the story again.
Yeah.
So I just shut up, sat still, and listened. And I loved it. But the interesting thing, on the side road of where we were camped, it was called Pooha Road. A week later, we're playing golf.
Mm.
He said, here, edit that for me, will you, mate? Mm. So there, I get the pen out and I'm editing, and he misspelled words or whatever you on the. And Barry was writing a book called Pooh-ha Road. And so I spent the next 6 weeks, because it took about that long to write it, I'm spending the next 6 weeks editing pages and having a look and helping knock it together in my own little way. And so I feel like some involvement with a very interesting thing about that story, Jared, is that it's been picked up for a movie.
Wow, isn't that wonderful?
Pooh-ha Road. The first time I'd met him, I was nine. Mum, he'd rung up Mum. He used to go past our place every fortnight for a few years and never managed to pop in. But on this day, he said, our birthdays are 2 weeks apart, Jared. Yeah. So he rang Mum up and said, what's Martin interested in? Mum said he likes a bit of carpentry. He said, oh, put him on the phone, will you? He said, hey, Marty, it's your dad here.
And this is the first time?
First time I've ever spoken to him. Yeah. I'm nine.
And you're nine. Wow.
And he says, it's our birthdays. He said, why don't we have a night out? I said, this sounds fantastic. He said, I'll pick you up at 6 o'clock. I said, great, looking forward to it. Well, he turned up at 11 o'clock that night with two cheeseburgers and a hammer and buggered off and never saw him for another 5 years. And that was the relationship. But look.
Two cheeseburgers.
And a hammer.
And a hammer.
Because I was interested in carpentry.
Now, the next time was you were in a dairy.
No, I was actually at Joseph Lucas Industries because at 14 I was a pleasant fool at school and I was asked to leave, give the other kids a chance to catch up, you know. And I wasn't quite 15, but I'd grown up a lot. And I was 6'2", 15 stone at 14, so I was a big boy. So I understand Barry not recognising me, but he came in looking for spare parts for his van that he was living in.
Gosh.
And I kept looking at him, I'm going, like this, to be sure. And then he spoke, and then I was sure. Because, you've got gravel for a voice, as you know, Jared. So he looks at me back and he goes, you got a lot of guts for a young fella looking adult in the eye like that. I said, is your name Barry? He goes, yes. Well, I'm your son, Martin. How are you, mate? So that was that, mate. And he ran around for a couple of days to try and, be the dad or do the dad thing. It never happened, never worked. Yeah. It was all, because to be honest with you, Jared, and straight up, and I hold, I'm not a victim and I hold no grudges.
Exactly.
But he could not be a dad to his own children. No matter how hard he tried. He could do other people's children, but not his own.
Now, what a great credit to you. There are some individuals in this world that would have taken that fact that they never knew their dad and justified a life of crime or a life of mistreatment of other people and then blame it on the fact that I never had a father.
No,
you've never let that happen, have you? So
no.
And so what's the difference between you and the victim mentality,
I think when you're armed with the right information about where Barry came from, there's no excuse for you to carry on the same way.
Exactly.
He went through something horrendous that I never had to go through.
Exactly.
A lot of people think that I had a bad upbringing.
Yeah.
I had a wonderful one. My stepfather was a beautiful man.
Yeah.
He came along when I was 5.
And a good mum. Good mum.
Fantastic mum.
Yeah.
Fantastic mum. I only knew love.
Yeah.
So I was lucky.
Yeah.
So I was brought up right. And Mum actually shielded me from Barry because she said, he's going to hurt you. It's going to happen.
Yeah, yeah.
And it did.
Yeah,
it came.
Yeah.
So she warned me. And she was there to pick up the pieces, as good old mums are, So that's just how it was. And so, look, I've never been able to do that. And I'm forever with my own children and spending so much time with them. And people ask me the same question. You're doing that because your dad didn't with you? Well, I go, no.
Yeah.
No, not at all. I'm just another parent. That when that little munchkin was born, I felt this incredible love and nurturing thing come over, and I've just carried on.
Yeah.
So I'm just doing a parent thing.
Rugby, racing and beer. You and I grew up in that era.
Yes.
Rugby, racing and beer. And Barry seemed to be the advertisement for, the good keen man and all that. So out of those three, which...
He looked like that. He spoke that language.
Yeah.
He lived it everywhere that you...
Yeah.
What you mentioned summed him up really well, but he never did. He was a big drinker.
Yep.
Smoker.
Yep.
But not racing.
Rugby, racing. What about rugby?
No.
No.
No. Loved the All Blacks.
Yep.
Didn't gamble, didn't bet or anything like that.
Didn't go to the races?
No, not really. He was just a citizen that wandered up and down the country and lived in various places. He needed change a lot, and so he moved. He just kept moving. So, about the big Kiwi bloke, the tough Kiwi bloke, is what he personified. Mm. But he was softer than that.
Now, if you could make the decision, would you be born again with a well-known father, or would you like to have the same upbringing but be a boy that forged your own identity without the fact that sometimes people come up and they always end up talking about Barry?
Yeah.
What would you have preferred?
Oh, good question, Jerry. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah, they did a documentary called In the Shadows.
Yes.
And there was myself, Rob Muldoon's daughter, Sam Hunt's son, and because we were living in the shadows of their parents, and so we did a documentary on it.
Yeah.
And a lot of things hit true to me then, because everybody that's ever really wanted to speak to me in the past wanted to speak to me because of who my father was, not because of who I was.
Exactly.
So I'm Martin, but to everybody else, I'm Barry Crump's son. Mm-hmm. And any journalist that's ever written anything about me or anything to do with us, I'm the son of Barry Crump.
Yeah, always
I'm not Martin.
Yeah, yeah.
But what happened was, when Barry died July 3rd, 1996, I had a very good friend of mine that put a good word into me with Bill Francis at News Talk ZB.
Yep.
And I put my first step into the public arena myself, because at Barry's funeral, a very good friend of Barry said, you know, when the tall trees fall, it lets a lot of light onto the little trees. Let's see what you can do, Marty. And I knew while I was cooking and chatting away to people that I wanted to do a little bit more than just be behind the scenes. I wanted to step out there. So I wrote a little radio show called Swing the Billy. And when
great
saw
title.
Bill,
when saw,
which is put a cup of tea on, that's the old man always said, swing the billy, will you, mate?
Swing the billy.
Yeah, put a cup of tea on. So I went along to Bill Francis at News Talk ZB, and I started the same weekend as Helen Brabazon and Kerry Woodham, and Kerry's still there.
Yeah.
Kerry McIver now.
Yeah.
And so I started, I've done 14 years of talkback after that. And the good thing about that, Jared, is that when you form that relationship, and you can't lie to your audience, because they're all of us.
Yeah.
They're up and down the country, they're everywhere.
Yeah.
And they're our people, and they're yours and mine.
Yeah.
And you can't lie to them. So I was just me, and I became Martin.
Martin Crump.
Yeah.
Now, Martin, we never got to talk about the end of it, but we got up to a certain stage before we started talking about your dad. But then Hunt for the Wilder People came out.
Yes.
It was released, finally.
Yeah.
And you're a little bit... You know, how's this going to go? Because there's another 25 books to go if this one goes, doesn't it?
Isn't that interesting? Because I said the same thing to Taika.
Yeah.
I said, this one falls over.
Yeah.
All our other projects are dead in the water.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We had it. So no pressure,
this
mate.
It's got to work.
No pressure.
And it worked, didn't it?
It was a wonderful
movie. I loved it. I loved it.
The interesting thing about it, Jared, is it's told a human interest story. It's about people. It's about you and I. It's about a little foster kid and a grumpy old white guy.
Yeah.
You know, it's that whole thing. How does that work?
Yeah.
But it did work.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing, Hollywood had brought out Batman versus Robin at the same time. Well, they took that one off. The cinemas in New Zealand were taking that one off and putting extra screenings of Hunt for the Wilder People.
Isn't that a compliment?
Well, you know, the biggest you could get. So it's turned over. It's been the biggest grossing movie of all time for a local movie.
Mm.
It even beat Boy. So Taika was caught up because Boy was his own personal movie, filmed where he was brought up himself. So, you know, very good.
Right. Now, tell me, I know we haven't got a lot of time, but where did you see it for the first time as a fully completed movie and with an audience?
At the premiere. So there was lights, camera and action, did about four or five interviews before I went in there. I had friends and family and I watched it and I left the cinema with my young daughter, who I drove home, and both of us drove in silence.
Wow.
And I said to her, did you want more? Did you expect more? And she said, yes, I did. I said, you know what, darling? So did I. And I don't know what that was. I was expecting, I was looking, there was such a lot going on at the night that I said, look, let's not do anything or even say anything about it until we watch it again in a couple of weeks and look at it through different eyes.
Yes, exactly.
So we did the sensible thing.
Mm.
We let the dust settle and then went back to the movies a couple of weeks later and watched it again and loved it. I've seen it three times now. I took my cousin along the last time. And I've got the DVD now. I love it.
Now, my favourite thing in the movie when the father gets out of bed, finally comes out, you know, he's sitting there with the young daughter and he gets out, opens the fridge and without looking at him, says, those bloody warriors. Mm. Now, that little piece of New Zealand Kiwi identification, you know, this guy, you know, how many years is it now? Nearly 20 years, people have been disappointed with the Warriors.
Oh, yeah.
That was included in the movie.
And the interesting thing was while I was at the premiere and there's a lot of people mixing out there, there was about five Warriors there. So they were sitting in the theatre when that was said.
They must have laughed.
And I've got no doubt that Taika had already told them this was coming up, you know.
Okay, now, it's all settled down now. Great success. What's the next...
Well, it's in the UK.
Yeah, it's
and
in the
doing,
UK.
And it's just been nominated for a British Independent Film Award.
Yeah.
So it's you know, it's carrying on. So it's great. It's great.
It'll go through each country.
It's got legs. Yeah, yeah. It's so it's just doing the rounds at the moment.
Well, what about another of Barry's books turning into a movie? What's the next one?
Pooh-ha Road. That's the next one. We've got.
Is that going to be with Taika or somebody?
No, Taika has just done Thor in Australia.
Yeah.
So he's mixing with the Hollywood glitterati right now. Taika's really tied up. He's the golden boy now and doing exceptionally well. And he's got. I've been told he's got about six or seven. I just saw him last week. Yeah. He's got six or seven. Projects backed up behind one another.
Wow.
He's a busy boy. So the producer, who's actually a friend of mine and who I've worked with two or three times, he's taken up the Pooh-ha Road, and I'm so pleased he's got it because I think he'll do great.
Martin, we could talk for about another 3 hours.
Oh, we could.
Well, we've only scratched the surface.
We've got a lot.
You know, so unfortunately, the show's got to go on. They're lining up out there.
I'll move on then. But hey, great to be here.
Martin, thank you very much.
Thanks, Dan.
See you again very soon.
Thanks for having me.
And Merry Christmas to you.
Oh, and to you.
Yeah.